Okay. Hi, this is John Mitchell, and you're listening to Sonic Perspectives. Hello, everyone, and welcome to another interview of Sonic Perspectives. My guest today has been in many, many bands, from It Bites, Frost, Kino, Lonely Robot, Arena, and more. John Mitchell. John, thank you so much for joining us.
It's a pleasure to be here, Rodrigo.
Did I get all the bands right, or am I missing anything? Or
You could have probably kept going for another 10 minutes. There probably some are that I've forgotten about. But I mean, there's various things, of course. The Urbane, I think. But then, these things don't always run concurrently. So once something is dead, people always go, well, you're in so many bands. Well, no, I was, or I have been participant in various bands over the years, but they don't all run concurrently, as it were. So no, I mean, Kino isn't really a thing anymore. So I don't know if you mentioned Kino, but you don't have to mention Kino.
I did mention, actually, I don't know if you remember, but the first time we talked was when the second Kino came out. But I
I
love
do
that
remember.
album.
Well, it was a thing that we did. It was a moment in time, and I'm glad that put it together. But everything has its place in history.
Fair enough. Well, we're here to talk about the new Lonely Robot album entitled A Model Life.
That's correct.
I'd like to start by asking what the title represents, because the last few years have been far from a model life for most of us, right?
Well, that's kind of exactly it, and so the title is somewhat a sardonic exercise, really. Quite so many things have gone wrong in a lot of people's lives, and we've lost a lot of people. A lot of people have died, and a lot of people have who formerly had certain roles in their lives in terms of jobs and what they did have had to re sort of reset what they do, and relationships have come to an end. And obviously the title, I just thought, well, yeah, this is far from a model life, so I call the album A Model Life, where I whine about the way things should be.
Well, you whine in a pop kind of way and in a somewhat positive kind of way for the most part. So,
For the most part, yes. It's I think I don't know. I don't I think none of the best music ever written was particularly I think people are drawn to sort of solemn or downbeat music. I mean, much as I love Katrina and the Waves Walking on Sunshine, I wouldn't want to listen to it on repeat, But even Roger Waters often makes mockery of himself when he talks about poor old whiny, when he I think I watched the DVD from The Wall Live, which he did a few years ago now, and he's talking about him. He does a duet with himself singing the song Mother, and he goes, "And here is where I accompany my miserable, unhappy, whiny younger self."
Well, there's a time and a place for every kind of music, I guess.
Yeah,
So,
there is.
well,
Except Simply Red. There's no time and a place for Simply
and duly noted, and I agree. Well, the press release did not mention it, but I'm assuming that just like all the other Lonely Robot albums, this one has you doing pretty much everything,
Yep.
and Greg Blundell on drums, right?
Yeah. I should probably be completely. I should hold my hand up and say, well, yes, he is on drums, but not in the way in which you might think. See, normally what would happen is that he would come to my studio, and we'd spend a day or two, just going through the songs quickly, putting down maybe three takes of each song, and he doesn't tend to get much notice when it comes to recording on my albums. I kind of just tend to let him turn up, and I'll play the songs a couple of times, and he'll chart them out. Then he'll do what Craig does, which is just try and be as interesting with time as he can be, you know, in terms of what he does within the measure of the song. Now, of course, I don't know if you've noticed, but Steve Hackett's been on tour for a very long time. I'm not entirely sure. I'm not convinced he owns a house.
Why would he, right? He's like,
right, he's never there. Yeah. He's always on tour. Which means that Craig is always on tour. So this time around much as I'd like to ring Steve Hackett up and say, Steve, go on, take a holiday, mate. it wasn't possible. And in the same way, I normally record Craig with V drums, because I just find that's the easiest way to work. And in this day and age, it's very easy to make. When I say V drums, I mean, you know, you're recording MIDI information, you know? Mm-hmm. So like an electric kit. And what I rang up Craig and said, I need to get these drums done for this album. And he said, well, I'm on tour. And I said, well, can we do it remotely? You know, whilst he's on the other side of the world, can you somehow, you know, hire a V drum kit, a TD-50 from Roland, because he's endorsed by Roland. So he could, I thought he might be able to get Roland to send him an electric kit out to his hotel room or something. Not that he, a day off should be a day of rest, not playing drums on my silly arm. Anyway, the practicality of we did talk about doing it remotely, and then I just realized that there wasn't going to be, I did set up a Dropbox with some of the mixes without drums on them, so he could try and do it remotely. But for one reason or another, you know, it didn't, I think he must have had his hands full or something, because, it didn't come to pass. So what I did instead was, it's in the spirit of green living and carbon neutral footprint, I recycled Craig Blundell.
Good stuff.
I found, you know, because he's played so many drum takes for me over the years, I went through a lot of the stuff and also there are songs and stuff where he's played drums that people haven't heard. So I found a bar of Craig here and I found a bar of Craig there, and you know, I recycled him, which is not ideal, but you know, when I did this album, you know, you have a deadline which you have to be quite strictly adhered to, because you know, it all hangs on, bizarrely, it all hangs on vinyl releases, and in order to get a vinyl printed in time, it has to be about 8 months in advance. So I didn't really want to miss my window of opportunity. So I
made a
decision. Yeah, and I was messaging Craig the other day, and he was asking about it, and you know, he kind of I think, you know, he knew that well, that's, I said I didn't want to get anybody else in on the record because he's a friend of mine, and we've, you know, he's played on pretty much everything I've ever done, you know, well, then certainly since I've known him for about 16 years now, I suppose.
Mm-hmm.
So I just thought, you know, rather than get somebody else in, I'm gonna recycle him,
and yeah,
we'll do it the way we normally do it. So yes, it is Craig's DNA in the songs, because they are, you know, it's Craig in binary MIDI form.
Good stuff. You reached your ESG goals on this album for sure. By recycling Craig, but that's,
yeah, exactly. I'm carbon neutral in terms of music.
And I think on the other Lonely Robot albums, you dealt with more sci-fi themes, but Feelings Are Good, the previous album, and on this new one, you opted for some more personal lyrics.
Yeah, I don't really, you know, it's like, I think I felt, you know, those first three albums are a trilogy, and obviously
self-contained,
self-contained trilogy, and you know, I didn't really, you can't, well, maybe I mean. You know, I felt I'd done everything I wanted to do with those sort of themes in mind, of, you know, the visual themes of the astronaut thing and the sort of lyrical ideas, the great big expanse ideas, and the continual reference to the pale blue dot and Carl Sagan, all those things that I sing about on those first three records. And I just thought, well, yeah. I just wanted to go back to making an album, which I thought, you know, go back to making music, which could be about anything, you know, not just about man's search for meaning, you know, on a rather sort of more, you know, on a rather more pretentious scale, as it were. So now these songs are a lot simpler and about more personal things, you know,
which is
like, but, you know, the title, I suppose, in a way, the title Lonely Robot, when I think about it, and why I thought Lonely Robot would be, it's quite fitting, really, because, working on this music as I do, largely on my own, and the way that I work, I work very long hours, and I work within a very strict period of time, and I don't get much sleep during that, and I just kind of like I'm like a I am a bit like a machine, not like a machine in that I'm not creative, but I'm very driven and set in my ways. So yeah, and obviously I don't, when I'm making an album, I don't really meet many people because I'm busy making the album. So Lonely Robot seems quite a fitting title. Nothing to do with astronauts or whatever. It's just quite an autobiographical title.
And another thing I noticed as well in terms of difference is the other previous covers had a lot of visual elements. This one that you can see here in the background is a lot more minimalistic, I should say. Did you have an influence on the end result or?
Yeah, no, totally. I knew exactly what I wanted it to be. I mean, it's a little bit different in that originally I wanted it to be, those signs you get like do not cross the road signs, or those stick men that you see. And originally I said to my friend Twig, who did it, I said I want it to be two stick people hugging. And he was like, really? So he showed me what two stick people hugging would look like, and I was like, yeah, that does look a bit crap. So we went for a line drawing instead, which is there was a, I just wanted it to be quite, like you say, it's very simplistic, and of course progressive rock albums are always like full of wizards and spaceships and stuff, aren't they? That's what
And
it's about.
mountains and dragons and
Mountains and dragons, and I zip Ryo Okamoto. I looked at his album cover recently. I was going, well, that is very proggy.
Came out
That's,
last week, I think.
and it's so proggy that my head hurts. And I just thought, actually, to be fair, with Lonely Robot, the first album, it's quite a simple image. It's just an astronaut holding out a robot. Second one is a bunch, me in a bed surrounded by a bunch of people with animals' heads on, which I suppose is a bit freaky. And the third one is an astronaut picking up a speaking spell from a desert, which I suppose I actually quite like that. Out of those three, that's probably my favorite. But like, yeah, then I kind of then I and then the last one's a bit rubbish, really. I thought I was being shocking, but it just looks bad. So with this one, I wanted to this one I really just wanted it to be. There was a company called Stylerouge who used to do a lot of album covers in the 90s, a lot of popular bands in the UK, and they used to do very simple but iconic album covers, and I wanted it to look kind of in the vein of what they might do, because life should be a lot simpler than it is, so I wanted a very simple drawing, to illustrate that.
That's an awesome concept. I love that cover. And as usual, we work with time constraints to write the album, something you really feel comfortable with, right? Does the ticking of the clock push you to write in any way?
Well, it's not even that. It's I just don't like protracted, elongated periods of time. I don't like things. I mean, it's funny. I've spoken. I know. I'm friends with quite a lot of musicians, and the way they go about doing things. I mean, the way that Marillion make albums is very. I mean, it's about as far away from the way that I would make it. I mean, they all get in a room and they jam.
Jam,
They have a
and they
jam
take the
session.
best of, right?
And it's not even them. I think they get their producer to listen to it all and glue it together with super glue, so it doesn't come apart. And I was like, well, that's great, but I mean, I can't imagine anything worse than jamming. I mean, jamming really is like it's. I mean, I'm not very good at jamming. Jamming is. Some people I rely. I mean, Pete Travers, who I've known for many years, he's a very spontaneous bass player. One minute he'll be thundering away down here, then he'll be up here like Chris Squire, then he'll be back down there, and he never, he's very, he's a very good spontaneous musician. He's very sort of creative, and he's very in the moment. Whereas I like to, I like, I just like the idea of, slowly composing things. Well, not slowly, but I don't like the idea of jamming and hoping for the best. It's not the way I at all, and the idea of doing it with five other people is horrific to me. So But they know what they do is great, and the way they go about doing it is great. So, I mean, what works for them, you know? And then I'm speaking to Steve Wilson about it, and he says he might write a song and then forget about it for 2 weeks and then come back to it and then change it and then do a bit more. And I'm like, man, I would have forgotten entirely what the whole thing behind the song was after 2 weeks. I mean, I like, you know, so maybe I've got some sort of musical ADHD or something, but I need to, that's where I shouldn't use that term of phrase because it is a, you know what I'm saying? Like, actually, it's quite entirely possible that's what it is because I just like to get inside the moment and not stop until the moment is over and it's finished, you know?
Well, funny you say that because I was speaking about a similar issue with Eric Johnson. He's a guy who takes his time in the studio, and he
You know,
mentioned
it's
that.
funny. It's funny you mentioning him because I spent an evening just watching Eric Johnson videos the other day.
Maybe you
Literally,
saw my interview with him.
I was what who was like Rick Beato. I was looking at his interview, and I'll look at yours next. Don't get jealous.
Fair
But
enough.
yeah, no, I was, yeah, he's I. Well, sorry, you're telling me a story. Sorry, carry on.
No, in the interview, he mentioned that Jimi Hendrix had an idea, and they had like 20 minutes in the studio, and that was when the Wind Cries Mary, and they did that in 20 minutes, no more.
That's exactly. Jimmy's right, and Eric should think about that. You know, the thing I like about Eric Johnson weirdly isn't his guitar playing. I really like his singing. Because I remember buying RVI music on as a kid and just thinking, "Well, you've got a really nice voice, man. You should make more of that. Stop with all this fast guitar playing and sing more." You know,
Absolutely.
I think he's a great singer. He's obviously a great guitar player, which is why I kind of got into his music. But then, you know, it's like he's a great singer as well, and I think he's a great singer.
Fully agree.
40 Mile Town's a beautiful song, Travis.
And well, back to Lonely Robot. The first song that was revealed is called Recalibrating. And I love the video treatment, which is very vintage looking.
Yeah, I mean that's just the thing about it is it's you know we yeah I didn't it was that was put together by a guy in Portugal which is he's yeah he's I had nothing to do with it and yeah it's kind of turned out cool. I mean I kind of the funny thing is before that I had some very very strong ideas about what I wanted each video to look like. And they might not be the best ideas in the world, but they were certainly my ideas, as it were. And we couldn't. And Miles, who normally does my videos, who I love working with, Miles Scarron at Crystal Spotlight, who's brilliant. And he did. He's done like all the stuff, pretty much most of the stuff that I've done visually. And he did that whole wonderful Under Stars kind of animated thing that he did, which was brilliant. So with as far as you know, the trouble was Miles is because he's so good, he's become very popular, and because he's very popular, that means you know the superstars in his world get preferential consideration, obviously. And as much as I'm a superstar in my own mind, Miles is busy with more successful people, and that's fine. So it's very difficult to tie Miles down to you know to getting to get him to work with me at the moment. And you know, and I kind of we lost a bit of time because I kind of wanted I had tried to find somebody else to do the video the way I imagined it, and for one reason or another, I kind of lost faith in that idea. And I thought, well, okay. And I said, Freddie, let's get the you know the guy out in Portugal to do something, and he did that, and he looks really cool and sort of you know very different. So yeah, it's a bit of fun, and I say it's a bit of fun. It's a very sad song, but in a way, I suppose uplifting in others. But yeah.
And there's another song in the album. It's called "That Digital God Machine," and I think it's a tribute to those who are on the internet telling people how to behave and how to do things. I'm curious about the sound effects at the beginning of the song and about your choice of theme for
Right, okay. So well look,
it.
I just there's one thing I don't understand, right? And it's really simple. If you don't like something, you know, my mum always said, if you've got nothing nice to say, just don't
Shut
say
up.
anything, you know. Maybe it's because I'm particularly English and my mum was particularly polite and was never rude to anybody unless they pissed her off. And when you knew when she was pissed off, but you know. She wouldn't, you know, and don't get me wrong. My mum wasn't a shrinking violet. You know, she used to go on C&D as an organisation in the United Kingdom campaign for nuclear disarmament, and she was vehemently opposed to nuclear weapons. She was a pacifist, and so she used to take me along to these marches. So if she believed in something, she would, you know, she would be outspoken about it. That being said, you know, she was always polite, and I just don't understand. And happy, you know, I find that the more popular your music becomes, or, you know, the more you, if you put something creative out there, there's always going to be some idiot that just wants to come along and
criticize. Yeah.
Well, not even, sometimes it's just, it's, I think this is a, you know, it is, yeah, criticize, but I think there's a facet of today's society is it's more important to have an opinion about whatever than not have an opinion at all, you know?
Yeah.
And I just, I see some of the comments that, you know, that, and, you know, very, you know, I suppose in a way I should be more zen and not let it upset me. And I don't let it upset, well, it upsets me because, you know, I mean, there was a guy recently who just kept sitting on my, my YouTube channel, who just kept going on about how he thought I was autistic. And I'm like, well, imagine if I was, how, what, why would that be a bad thing?
You yeah.
know? Don't the He's... Google campus hire people on the autistic spectrum because they're far better functioning with figures. I actually am slightly on the autistic spectrum in certain, don't read certain social situations very well, but, in terms of, I thought, what a horrible thing to keep going on about, you know. Just,
absolutely.
Yeah, yeah. What does it make yourself look like an idiot? Like, yeah. It's bullying, you know. And
yeah.
And then, you know, it's just, it, maybe it's, is it particular to progressive rock? And I don't think it is particular to progressive rock. It's just, it seems to me that, you know, you get a lot of people who are very blunt and very, say some very forthright things and without, or maybe it's just people these days in general, now that they yeah. have I don't get it, you know. It's like I've never ever felt the need to go onto a band's forum and go, you know, like onto any band's forum. I mean, you know, there are some progressive rock bands I'm not massively fond of. Like, I mean, I'm not massively, I know that you're in Toronto, I'm not massively fond of Rush, but I know, like, I'm going to tell you why I'm not massively fond of Rush. It's nothing to do with Rush. They can't help this, right? But when I was a kid growing up, right, you're supposed to discover your own music, aren't you?
Yes, of course.
And I was in a band with these two guys at school, and they forced me to listen to Rush. I had to learn Rush songs so that we could play Rush songs in our set. I learned all these songs like La Villa Strangiata, and of course, I can't sing these songs because it's way too high.
Right. Well, La Villa is an instrumental, so.
Yeah, and I'm going, hey guys, this is great, but why don't we listen to some Iron Maiden now? And they were like, no, fuck Iron Maiden. I'm like, well, fuck Rush. So that's been my attitude ever since. But it's not Rush's fault. I've watched that Behind the Lighted Stage documentary about six times. They seem like really nice people, and
they are.
Yeah. I actually quite like a lot of their. I really like. Is it Power Windows? The '80s stuff where they the
cinema Power Windows. Yeah.
The stuff that probably diehard Rush fans don't really like, I really do like. I think when Rupert Hine got involved in them, that sounded good to me, you know?
Right.
But well, I would never, the point I'm making is I would never go on Rush.com or whatever on their forum. I don't know if they've got a Rush.com forum, but I would never sit there going, Rush are terrible, especially, yeah. God, this new album, you know, obviously they're not a thing anymore, but, you know, if I'd have, I would never wouldn't dream of doing that. I mean, why would you not do that? Yeah. I don't want to upset Alex Lifeson.
Of course, yeah.
He's well, like a fun guy.
Yeah. Well, and they have a song from 1989, and this is pre-internet, where it goes like, "Everyone knows everything, and no one's ever wrong." And that's applicable for the internet today, not just in music, every subject, right? We had specialists in COVID, and then Ukraine, now Taiwan. Everyone knows everything about everything. So
yeah, and everybody wants to say that they know everything about everything.
Exactly.
That's the other problem, Yeah, it's funny you should mention that song, because there was a guy on one of my forums the other day, you know, because I did one of the video for the Island of Misfit Toys. This guy clearly didn't like the song, and he said, I really hope the rest of the album isn't as bad as this.
Oh.
And I replied to him saying, well, it's funny enough, the next single is going to be called Digital God Machine, which is all about fans of music who have a very outspoken opinion about what I should be doing and feel the need to share it with me. So I thought you might find that relatable.
Right.
That's irony.
And I think in a certain way, I think the album ends on a trilogy because I feel like Rankin's Duty of Care and In Memoriam are somewhat related
Yeah, they
thematically.
are.
I'm
Well,
a,
yeah,
yeah.
thematically, Rankings is about the fact that when I was, it's very much going back to the hardship that is being English. The hardship. English people are quite famous for being reserved and not as emotionally
Stoic,
stoic.
yeah.
Good use of the term. Very stoic. And Rain Kings, I remember my cousin saying to me once, and my dad used to say this to me, he said, whatever you do, if you're upset about something, you mustn't cry in front of people. It's a sign of weakness. And I remember thinking, God, okay. Yeah, that's kind of what it's about, and the fact that that's about the worst advice you should ever give to anybody, because releasing emotion is exactly that, a release. And I think that kind of advice has set back the male of the species, of the English formant, for decades and decades. And I think, I wish it wasn't that way, and I wish it wasn't ingrained in me, because instead of letting emotion out, you let it build up in you, and you find yourself, instead of being upset, you find yourself instead replacing that with anger, and that's an even worse emotion, So
Of
yeah, that's
course.
what that's about. And then Duty of Care is kind of about the conflicted relationship I had with my dad, and indeed the fact that my mum was completely the opposite of that, and she was a very loving person and just a really kind woman. And it was, I it is about my two parents. And then finally, In Memoriam is about the fact that I think I in conclusion I have spent a large amount of my life trying to live up to some imaginary because my dad died when I was 12, and I think I spent a lot of my life trying to live up to some imaginary expectations which he may or may not have had placed upon me had he remained living. Trying to live up to some sort of ideal or level of success, which he had. He was a successful guy, and of course, I'm adopted, so I'm from a point of view. I mean, there's some interesting documentaries about the nation of nurture or nature or nurture. There's a very interesting documentary on Netflix called, I think it's Stranger Next Door, about three triplets that were adopted off and put in different homes, and how their upbringings,
Changed.
changed their outlook and how completely different they were as people because of their upbringing. And I remember thinking, yeah, I mean, certain things about you and I are going to be good at certain things. I'm not, in terms of, I'm terrible with money and academia, and I'm not very good with figures. I'm not a mathematician. I would make a terrible mathematician. But from a creative perspective, I think my strengths are in the creative field. Like in painting, and I did an art scholarship and making music, et cetera, et cetera. And so I could never. My dad was a civil engineer. He started out being a civil engineer, and he was always about figures and maths and, a practical point. A practical sort of scientific approach to things. And that's just not me. So why I put all these expectations on a completely different career path, completely. And I think it's only in the re last couple of years I've come to think of it. Well, I am my own person, and he's been gone a very long time, and you kind of got to get past that, really. So that's kind of what the last song is about,
I didn't know you were adopted, and in that sense, I guess the island of misfit toys takes a complete different meaning for me because it's about adopted kids, right?
It is, yeah, absolutely. I'm
Incredible.
glad you picked up on that, and of course, well, anybody that's adopted, well, not anybody, but a lot of people. I mean, I've got two of my best friends, Jez Fielder and Paul Fielder. They were both adopted, and you couldn't imagine, they're adopted from different parents to the same family, and I cannot imagine two closer siblings. Even though they're not blood related, I can't imagine two people who are, who love each other more and are more sort of in tune with each other. And that comes through, growing up together and bonding with it. So it just goes to show you that, there are facets that there's certain biological things that you can't misstep, like, you know, your hair might fall out. I mean, that's not going to happen to me, obviously, but it's all still there.
Fingers crossed.
Yeah, and that's kind of, you know, and I remember, I remember, I've never remembered a time when I didn't know that I was adopted. I mean, I've always known I was, and my mum was very clear about that. But I remember, you know, standing between them in St. Paul's Cathedral at Christmas time, and they were singing. And yeah, it was like listening to two cats being murdered, and that's when I realized I was adopted.
I'm glad you didn't pick up on that particular facet. So for sure, yeah, you have a great voice.
I'm just, well, no, actually, I'm kidding because I couldn't sing then either. But you know, it's funny, you know, when I was my when my son Sasha was little, and I used to just amuse myself because he used to get really embarrassed when I would sing at him. You know, just I'd sing songs, you know, just to just because I spent a lot of time just singing to myself when I'm walking around the house, and I used to sing at Sasha, and he goes like, "Dad, stop singing, it sounds bad."
Well, yeah, I'm glad to tell you, you found your voice definitely because, you know, I was talking to a friend of yours, Matt Stevens from The Feast and the Dead the other day.
Oh yeah.
And the minute I hear you singing, I know it's you. And it's a quality that a small group of vocalists these days possess. So,
Oh, thank you. That's very
right.
kind of you. Yeah, I mean, that's out of everything that I do, you know. That, I mean, I started playing piano when I was about six, and I started playing violin when I was about seven, and guitar when I was about 12 or 13, because I thought, you know, I'd get loads of girls. I used to like, you know, yeah, man, look at Bon Jovi. They've got loads of girls. I want to be like Bon Jovi. So I started playing guitar, and I thought, you know what? This is too much fun. I'm going to join a progressive rock band and not get girls.
There you go, mission accomplished.
Mission accomplished. Why didn't I join Chic? But you know, the singing was the last thing I kind of started doing, and I, you know, it's taken a long time and a lot of practice and a lot of kind of learning, because some people just start singing when, you know, when they're in their teens and they're really good at it, and that was not me at all. I was awful, awful, awful. And it's really only in recent years when I've got to a point where I feel comfortable doing it. And it's always been a case of I was the singer because nobody else wanted to do it. So like in Kino, we originally had Ray Wilson, who was going to sing for us, you know, the guy from Stiltskin and Genesis. And then he changed his mind. He was like, I don't want to be in a band anymore. And I can't say I blame him because neither do I. But you know, for a while he was going to be the singer, and then he bailed out on it. And then we, you know, I was talking to Thomas Varver, and it was like, well, maybe we can get the guy from Mr. Mister. Maybe we can get this guy, man. And eventually I just thought, I'll do it. I'll do it. All right, calm down, everyone. I'll do it.
I'm glad that that was the
Yeah, and I kind of listened back to that. I can't really listen to that first Kino album now. I was like, oh, that sounds terrible. But you know, it's over since that time, since 2005, I've probably got a bit better at it just through continually doing it. So
I think we're running out of time, but before I let you go, what are the plans for your other future or your other endeavors like Frost, Arena, It Bites?
I'm going to leave all of those bands. Yeah, it's just going to be a dummy robot from now. No, I'm done with bands. Well, we finished an Arena album about 3 weeks ago, so that's now done. So that's the end of that for some time. It Bites. Well, we kind of have to do an album. We signed a contract, and I just haven't got round to it yet, but I will when it starts getting colder and I don't want to go outside anymore. We'll release it. Well, recording It by some Frost. Well, that's just down to Jem, you know, because Jem's a busy guy, and I know that he's very busy with, you know, he does a lot of sort of media based stuff for radio too, and does a lot of stuff for radio. So it's we just have to work it around, you know, as and when he wants to fit that in, or if indeed he wants to do another record. We've got a tour in November, which I think is going ahead. So yeah, those things are all going to happen. But you know, for now, I'm happy with this album. You know, I want, you know, it's like, you know, I might never do another Lonely Robot album, so I wanted this one to be as you know, what I think is certainly my favorite of all of them. You know.
Right. And then you do have live dates planned for Lonely Robot, right?
Yeah, we did. We got
Yeah.
them in February. And again, it's down to, I mean, I don't want to sound like a negative ninny, but it's down to whether or not they've, a lot of people are not taking a chance on going to concerts still. So whether or not, if it's financially feasible to do. And of course, because of Brexit, it's cost inefficient going to Europe at the moment for people in the UK. So we'll see. I mean, I want them to go ahead because we've rescheduled them twice already, and it's getting beyond a joke now. So let's just I hope by February more things are sorted out, and we've sold millions of tickets, and
Yeah.
I can go there without any worry.
Fingers crossed. John, absolutely. Thank you so much for the interview and all
Very
the
welcome.
best.
I'm very shiny, so anybody who it's these people who watch this, are they? Right, so
Yes.
I really sorry everyone, my makeup assistant let me down, sorry, and I don't have my powder puff to hand, so apologies.
That's all right. That's all
okay
right.
okay
Thank you so much, man. All the best. Cheers.
bye-bye.